Hello, welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. Well, every year on January 1st, have you made sort of resolutions? I'm not going to eat so much, I'm not going to drink so much, I won't smoke. And at the bottom is the sort of the idea, I bet I can look better if I do all of those things. Well, yes, you can. And if you read my guest book, Dr. Andre Berger, he's written The Beverly Hills Anti-Aging Prescription, the age-defying program to feel better, look younger, and live longer. It's published by Infinity. Welcome, Dr. Berger.
Thanks so much. Great to be here today.
Thank you. And certainly at this time, for the first of the year, we're starting to make our resolutions. Now, how do people come to you, or who recommends them?
Well, people come to me in different ways. Hopefully now one of the ways they'll come to me is after they've read my book, they will definitely want to come to me. But generally people come to me, I've been in practice for quite some time. So I'm known in the community. So I get referrals from other physicians.
Yeah.
I get referrals from happy patients who want to recommend their family members or friends. And I also get referrals through our marketing that we do through, for example, our website, et cetera. So through different forms of outreach. That's how I get patients.
Your training was?
Internal medicine, clinical pharmacology, also board certified in emergency medicine. Of course, a diplomate of the American Academy of Anti-Aging and Regenerative Medicine and American Board of Holistic Medicine. So I have a kind of a diverse background.
So we have now established the credentials.
Right.
Book begins with people coming to you and you have them fill out a questionnaire.
Well, if you don't know where you're going, any road will take you there.
Yeah.
So it's important to understand what's going on with people. Where are they at in life? They'll come to me and they'll have a story to tell, and I have to really understand their story. Because in order to help people, there's a few things that have to happen. First thing is, you have to kind of understand their history, the history of their life, their lifestyle, all the things that they have been subjected to. Because what happens to you and to me is a product of two things. About 35% of it, that you got from your parents.
Mm-hmm.
That's genetic. But the other percentage, the 65%, that's the environment. And their story is going to tell me a little bit about both. It's going to tell me about a little bit of their family history and all the things that they are more likely to be at risk for because of family history and genetic history. And then it's going to tell me about all the things that they've done in their life up until this point that have led them to feel or look this way and also will determine their longevity. And that's an important story for me to start with.
You obviously have had psychiatric training. Because I would think as people are going through some of the questions, they may have part of them that they've hidden. And suddenly, you're asking them, show me the naked self.
You know, it's not that I've had psychiatric training per se. In other words, I'm not a trained psychiatrist. But many patients ask me if I've had psychiatric training.
Yeah.
So that's a great question. Because in all the years I've been doing this, I've learned that you have to really find a way to go deep. All the way to the core. And to do that, you have to be patient and you have to listen. Listening is the most important thing. But then after listening, you have to ask the right questions and continue to ask them until you feel you've got about as much out of the person as you can at that moment and then carry on.
Now we say, here is Mary Smith. She's, 42? She's married, second marriage. Two kids, they're 20s. And she's not happy with herself. She feels, I'm looking older. I can't go for an interview on a job because they're only hiring younger. And she says to you, change me overnight, in essence.
Right. Well, that's a very tall task she's given me to do overnight. We certainly can, what I tell my patients is when they come and see me is one thing. I expect them to tell me what their expectations are. So in Mary's case, she says, change me overnight. And I'm going to explain to her that that's not a realistic expectation because you can turn the Titanic around on a dime, but you can turn it around. And as I tell my patients, if you want to be 100% successful, there's only really one thing you have to do. And that thing is you have to do what I tell you.
Yeah.
And I can only tell them that after I've kind of understood what their problems are, and that's through evaluation, through asking these questions, and then testing them, doing some laboratory testing.
Interesting, the laboratory testing. You do blood. There were three types of testing that you're doing. What do you look for?
Well, there are more than three, but there are three basic things we start with, and we do some blood tests. Mm-hmm. We do some saliva testing.
That was the one I was surprised at. And urine, of course.
And urine testing. And they're looking for different things. It's a very comprehensive look at the person in terms of their markers of aging, their markers mm-hmm. of inflammation, and some other factors, because, of course, we're very complex. Humans are very complex physiological beings. And if we compartmentalize things, we're never going to get to the bottom. So we have to look at the whole person. And we have to understand how one thing affects all the others, and then put all that together as far as we know today with the knowledge we have in order to clean up the dirty soup that your genes are swimming in.
Yeah. When they come to you, do they have to sign sort of like a contract that I will do what I'm told?
Well, they have to sign an agreement that says that, you know, they're going to be compliant with the program. But I make it very clear to them that what I offer is tough love.
Yeah.
Because I like to see success stories, and they all want to see success stories. So a great marriage is made when we're both determined to do what it takes. Now, I'm not asking for perfection, because that's an unrealistic goal for anybody, because we're humans, mm-hmm. and we're not perfect. And people are going to make mistakes, they're going to slip, and that's fine. But what we offer is support for that. But if somebody is unwilling or unable, after support and, you know, continuing to try, then that's a problem. And then, you know, we have to take a step back and say, well, are you really ready for this kind of program? Mm-hmm. Maybe this is not something that you're ready for. And if you're not ready for it, you can't expect it to work for you.
Yeah. There was one person who came in, and I guess was quite overweight, wanted to lose 50 pounds. And you said, wait a minute, let's start with 5, in essence. Let's see, take the baby steps before you try to jump over the lake.
Well, I mean, if you just think about it in just a realistic perspective, 5 sounds like a doable task. 50 sounds like, you know, a huge, almost impossible task. So you don't have to start at 50. You can go 5 at a time and get to 50 and 55 and 60 and go from there. And that really is much more effective in motivating people.
The gut and the internal system.
Well, the gut is incredibly important. There are many things that most people don't appreciate, and that is how fundamental the health of our gut is to our overall well-being, including our brain, including our bones, and every other facet of our living, our immune system, very much is entwined with our gut. It starts with, for example, the organisms that live in our gut. We have almost a marriage with these organisms, and we have to have a really good relationship with them in order to feel well. So we need healthy gut organisms, gut flora, and that's very critical. And then we need good functioning of our gut, because our gut is critical for us to absorb nutrients properly.
Yeah.
And we need that. And then also protect us from getting the bad stuff in that shouldn't be coming in. And also, surrounding our gut is most of our immune system. That's where it is. It's all the way surrounding our gut. So all of those things need to be appreciated. So gut health is really important.
Dental health, too.
Absolutely. Dental health is critical. So in my book, as I point out, you need to have good dental health to have overall general health. And dental health, including problems with gums, chronic infection, problems that you don't take care of, can lead to serious and significant health issues, including heart issues.
Would you read this paragraph here?
Sure. In the practice of holistic anti-aging, there is a fine line between doing everything that needs to be done and doing enough to achieve improvements that can be seen, felt, and appreciated. That is part of the art of anti-aging medicine, always moving in the right direction. This goes for doctors as well as patients. If you see a doctor who is an advocate of anti-aging, but looks like he or she is not following their own message, they aren't going to have a lot of credibility.
And so I say to my guests here, do you exercise?
I exercise every day. Mm-hmm. So I'm an avid exerciser and a gym member, and I exercise about at least an hour a day, a full 7 days a week.
Mm-hmm. a treadmill or?
Well, I do a variety of things. I do aerobic exercise, so I use a treadmill. Yeah. I use elliptical device, which is what I mostly use for my aerobic exercise. Mm-hmm. And then I'll do resistance training, whereby I use weights. And then I'll do stretching, and I'll do flexibility training and balancing.
Do you have a room in your office that has this equipment? And do your patients come in and use it?
No.
No.
I don't really advocate that. I think patients should get used to exercising wherever it is that they enjoy and feel comfortable to exercise in their own environments. So whether it be going to a gym, whether it be getting a trainer to come and help them in their homes, whether it be doing it outdoors, wherever it may be, the most important thing is that they do it.
Yeah.
And I don't really care where they do it. As long as they're doing it, we can find a way to help them to find the right type of exercise that works for them so they get successful.
Poor nutrition. I mean, you can have people who go to fast food restaurants and they say, well, I had a salad, but I used their dressing. Well, forget it. They have already wiped it out. The importance of protein, carbohydrates, but the right sort.
Well, food is very important because food is medicine. I mean, food is more important medicine than I could prescribe for any of my patients over time, because food is really nature's medicine. It will determine not only how much energy you have, but the ingredients of food are actually triggers. And they are vehicles whereby your whole metabolism can either work well or can have problems. And it can trigger, bad food can actually trigger problems such as mutations in your DNA. So imagine what that might mean. Mm-hmm. So food has to be respected. And one of the problems we have in our society is a loss of respect for what we put in our bodies.
Yeah.
Because we're not really taught that. It's not really cultural. We're influenced by advertising. I call it the SAD, which some people call the standard American diet, but I call it the sad American diet.
Yeah.
Because it is really what we know, but mostly inappropriate for people to achieve the things that they're looking for, and that is looking better, feeling better, and living longer. You're not going to get that on the standard American diet.
You have the glycemic load sample, and that's an interesting, everybody should have it up in their refrigerator.
Well, I think so. I think carbohydrates are a problem when they're processed carbohydrates. I mean, I think if people just, there's a few things, if people could just do a few things, like stay away from processed foods, okay, mm-hmm. which, and especially processed carbohydrates, they'd be doing a lot better in terms of wellness, and
yeah.
they'd live longer, and they'd feel better. Staying away from wheat products. Glycemic load, it really only refers to carbohydrates. And if you can get a book or a chart that explains this and stick to carbohydrates that have a load of 10 or less, you're going to be very successful. Now, most unprocessed carbohydrates, that is fruits, vegetables, legumes, etc., they all naturally, for the most part, almost all of them, have a load of 10 or less. So you can eat as much of those as you like.
An apple a day.
That's absolutely right.
All right.
But an apple a day tells another story, and it tells a story about fiber, because that's the issue of processed carbohydrates.
Yep.
Most of them have fiber extracted. An apple has got sugar, but it's got fiber, and it holds back that sugar from getting into your bloodstream too quickly, and that therefore not bringing up your insulin level too quickly. And that's the real problem, is that as the insulin level mm-hmm. rises and falls, and that over time exhausts your ability to be sensitive to it, and then you develop weight gain and prediabetes and eventually diabetes, which you know we have an epidemic of in our society.
And that word fiber will then keep your colon happy.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. You do need a certain amount of bulk, and fiber is an excellent source of natural bulk in order for you to have better colon health.
Tell me about your attitude towards vegetarianism.
Well, I think vegetarianism can be looked at in different ways. Vegetarianism actually can be a better form of diet for many people, as long as they make sure that they have certain nutrients that may be a little bit difficult to achieve in a pure vegetarian diet. But for the most part, vegetarians tend to have better body composition.
Mm-hmm.
They're leaner, and the studies have shown so far that actually vegetarians live longer. They do have a longer lifespan. But it's not necessary to be 100% vegetarian. I think if you stick to a plant-based diet, when I say based, primarily plant-based, but you can add a little bit of animal protein, okay, to that diet, you'll probably do just fine. But the emphasis should be on plant-based foods. And if you do that, you'll have lower calories because obviously plants are low in calories. Yeah. You'll have great nutrition because they're rich in the nutrients we need as human beings. And that will contribute to cleaning up your dirty soup.
And organic foods. I mean, really, is there, you know, you go to the market, is that organic worth the difference from, say, a banana? This one's not organic, this one is.
Well, I would ask you a different kind of question. Is it worth it to you to have food that is better for you in terms of your long-term health or not? If it's not, then it doesn't make a difference. If it is, then it does.
Yeah.
And remember, food is medicine. So if you have pesticides, if you have artificial preservatives and pesticides and all kinds of other toxins, mm-hmm. you know, that are used in the process of agriculture to get more crop, okay, if you have that problem and you're ingesting that, and that's going to cause problems, including DNA mutations over time, even drinking out of a plastic bottle where the phytates in the plastic leach out and can cause DNA mutations. If that's not important to you, well, then don't bother with it. But if you want to achieve the goals set forth here and maximize your opportunity, then think about it. Respect what you put in your body. Organic food, certainly, it's not perfect, but it's better.
What about animals that are fed hormones? And you may also have been prescribed hormones by a doctor. And suddenly you're having a great amount of hormones in your body. And I do know, had done some research with some of the doctors at UCLA, and hormones can cause cancer.
Well, there's a lot of misconception about hormones. There's a lot of literature out there, and people have you know, hung on to some ideas that may not be exactly right or correct.
Yeah.
So I think this is something that we should put in perspective. So when you say hormones can cause cancer, well, we could say that aspirin can make you bleed to death.
Mm-hmm.
We can say that, I mean, so anything you take, any medication you take, has a possible risk. So let's just admit that straight out. The question is, what is the risk versus the benefit? And let's look at that. And then you have to understand, well, hormones, there are so many hormones. I mean, thyroid is a hormone, okay? Progesterone is a hormone. Testosterone is a hormone. Estradiol is a hormone, for example. Pregnenolone is a hormone. Cortisol is a hormone. Insulin is a hormone. Mm-hmm. There are many hormones. So the question is, when you say hormones cause cancer, let us now say that that's not a fair statement. What we have to say is, well, what are we referring to? So really the only thing that has, there's a couple of things we have to think about. And I think the three that people are most concerned about are estrogen, okay? And second thing was a question about growth hormone, okay?
HRT.
And the third was testosterone. So let's just put that to bed right now, okay? And we can say this. And it's spelled out in my book. There is no evidence whatsoever in the medical literature that substantiate any claim that testosterone causes cancer, period, unequivocally.
But estrogen has...
Well, we'll get to estrogen next.
All right.
So estrogen, there definitely is some evidence that in certain females, estrogen can increase their risk for breast cancer. We know this, okay? But then we have to examine the facts, okay, and the studies. Now, these studies are not perfect. They're far from perfect, and they don't actually answer all the questions. They actually lead to more questions. Now, but what we do know is the studies were primarily conducted using synthetic hormones, not natural hormones, not bioidentical hormones. So that certainly leaves us a big question mark. Does that apply to all types of estrogens? Maybe not. Also, these patients were also on progestins. Yeah.
The combination. Yeah.
The combination was off.
Yeah.
The hormone was not exactly the right type of hormone. So there are more questions than answered. But to generally explain it to you, I would say this. If you are a woman in menopause and you are suffering, you can't sleep, you're depressed, your life is basically over. You feel terrible, okay? So you're looking for a solution. You're looking for an answer. And you have to evaluate the risk and reward. So if I tell you that there is a slight risk, a small risk, mm-hmm. okay, and we've eliminated your family history, so you don't have a large, there's a small risk, versus a reward of making you feel better. Most women, you know, given that kind of informed consent, will choose to feel better, to have a life.
Well, they look younger.
They will look younger, absolutely, yeah. because estrogen, testosterone, all these hormones are essential in the integrity of your connective tissue. Your skin will look better. It'll look firmer. It'll look less saggy. It'll look brighter. All of those things, all hormones are essential for connective tissue strength and health, and also for skin appearance. Mm-hmm. So absolutely they will look better.
Dr. Heal Thyself, do you take any of those?
Well, I take what I need. So in other words, I do what I expect my patients to do. I get evaluated, and if I have any deficiencies, I get them corrected. So I'm in a youthful, safe and youthful balance.
Okay. Now, you've got all of that going for you. How am I going to get a good night's sleep?
Oh, this is the curse of our society. Thomas Edison, you know, it was a blessing and a curse, you know, because before him, you know, we had electricity, we lived by mostly, you know, sun and light and darkness. You know, how bright could a lantern or a little fire, a candle be? Can't really light up a room. So now we have 24-hour daytime, and that's really screwed us all up. So sleep is a problem. Then we have also a crazy society where there's pervasive stress in our society, and people don't sleep. And if you don't sleep, you'll never be well. It's not possible to ever be well if you don't sleep. And you'll never look well, you'll never feel well, and you'll have a shortened lifespan. This has definitely been proven.
There are 27 hints here.
Well, those are hints, but there's even more concrete steps, even before the hints. And they're very important. They're spelled out pretty well in the book. Mm-hmm. And I have to help patients every day to sleep better. Yeah. And we can be very successful in sleeping better if you just follow what I tell them. And most of that is spelled out in the book.
Tell me right now. Say I didn't sleep well, I'm having problem, whatever, stress even that comes into it. What should I be doing?
Okay. Well, the first thing you have to understand is there's two things involved. One is behavior. So you have to correct your behavior. And the second is you have to see if there's any obstacles, such as hormonal obstacles, et cetera, that are an issue. So if you have low levels of melatonin, for example, mm-hmm. or if you have high levels of cortisol, or even very low levels of cortisol, if you're eating late at night and your insulin goes up and it comes down, you might have a problem with sleeping. Mm-hmm. If you have hormonal imbalances, if you are in menopause and you have low estrogen, or even males with low testosterone, this will cause sleeping imbalances.
There's a little light in the room. That's, you say that's a no-no.
That's behavioral, absolutely. Yeah. So for some people, they are very sensitive to light. Any type of stimulation should be avoided before sleep. In other words, low lights, low music,
etc. No TV.
Well, if you're going to watch TV, make sure it's not violent, and it's not too loud, and it's not too bad news.
So, what about wearing eye masks?
Eye masks are great if it helps you block, ambient light, and if ambient light is a problem for you. It's absolutely great because it'll emulate darkness, and that's what you need when you sleep.
Yeah. So what was it? Somebody said, there is no human who can really sleep with the lights on.
Well, it's a challenge. It's very difficult to sleep with the lights on.
Yeah.
Some people, unfortunately, in order to sleep, have to take medication, which is not a cure for insomnia. It's not a treatment for the problem. It's a cover-up for a problem that has to be looked at deeper in the way I've suggested, and sleep well naturally. That's the ideal for what I've said, live longer, feel better, and look better.
And who would be, of course you're not going to name names, but you have had people who've made that transition.
Absolutely. All my patients who do what I tell them do make that transition.
Yeah.
They only have to do what I tell them, and they will be successful, because for most patients, there is an answer. You just have to start asking the right questions to get to the bottom of what the problem is. If you there is a reason that people feel and look, the way they do. There's a reason that people have problems. You have to find the answer. Instead of just throwing a medication at people, you need to go deeply and try and find out what is at the bottom of the problem.
And that's when they have to read the page 229, Repairing the Damage.
Yes, repairing the damage. So it's one thing to prevent. It's a lot easier to prevent than it is to repair.
Yeah.
Repair is more difficult and more challenging because you already have damage done. But you can actually repair a lot of damage. You can improve.
I thank you very much, Dr. Berger, and would you please sign my book?
It would be my pleasure. Thank you
so much.
And
if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.conniemartinson.com. You can read our columns from the Beverly Hills Courier, and you can also go to YouTube, and you'll be able to see this show or recommend it to a friend to see it. That's really wonderful, the fact you can see a show and then say, oh, so-and-so didn't see it that day, they should have. There it will be. Now, visit your local library. Have you been there lately? That, too, will keep you young. Going to the library, reading books, keeping stimulated. As a matter of fact, anybody who reaches a certain age should be taking a lesson in how to use your computer, how to. And even if that means going out in your backyard and painting a fence, that too is part of getting pleasure out of doing and being constructive. Well, in your library, you will find all of the books on advice that you will ever need about keeping stimulated. And they also have things like book fairs. And you have any books you're not using, donate it. They can use it in their book sales. And that helps support the library. And we'll see you next time. Thank you very much, Dr.
Thanks, Connie. It was a pleasure.
Thank you.
Enjoyed it.